Gift of grace is Jesus, my Redeemer. Christ in me. No wrongs we have done. Omniscient, all-knowing, he counts not their sum. Thrown into a sea without bottom or shore. Our sins, they are many. His mercy is more. And what patience would wait as we constantly roam? What Father so tender is calling us home? He welcomes the weakest, the vilest, the poor. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. Praise the Lord, his mercy is more. Stronger than us, new every morn. Our sins, they riches of kindness he's lavished on us. His blood was the payment, his life was the cost. We stood neath the debt we could never afford. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. Praise the sins, they are many, his mercy is more. Stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. When the race is complete, still my lips shall repeat, yet not I, but through Christ in me. In me.
kids, if you'll go to the back, get ready for children's church. Hey, Chase. All right, so we'll go ahead and let the kids know that we love them on the count of three. One, two, three.
We love you.
We love you.
We love you too.
All right, we'll see you later. So, okay, we're going to be looking at the omniscience of God today. This is a tall order. I don't expect that anybody in this room, on this planet, any human will ever comprehend the omniscience of God. Ever. But we're gonna take a stab at it today. I mean, I don't even know why I'm preaching today. What do I say? When you go through all of the characteristics, the everything who God is, there's just no way to adequately explain everything about him. It's just impossible. This topic today, I'll be shocked if we get through it. I will be shocked. This is something. The omniscience of God. The fact that he knows everything. And I would say the best way to approach this today is by faith. Not blind faith, but by faith. I'm not asking you, and the Bible doesn't ask you to throw out reason. I'm not asking you to go into blind faith, but trust God. Look at his word and trust him. As a matter of fact, for people, it should be a thing, when we look at God, it should be a thing where we go, man, I do not understand him totally. There's something there I just can't put my finger on. It should be like that, because he's God. He's God. He knows all things. He's able to handle all things. He knows the past, the present, the future. He knows all of eternity. Oh, and by the way, since he knows all things, guess what? This is pretty popular around this church. There is no such thing as luck. Hello? I mean, if I hear another Christian go, good luck, I'll pull out the rest of my bald spot that's in the back. I mean, there is no such thing as luck. If God is sovereign, and he is, then where is luck? Where is the book of luck? Where can that be found? I don't know. But God's truth has a book called the Bible, where his promises are yes and amen. So there's no kind of weird incantations, I wish you good luck, and all the rest. No. That should be totally foreign from the Christian. And when you look at the omniscience of God, the fact that he knows everything, you let me know in that economy where there's room for luck. There's no such thing as luck, no such thing as chance. That's a bonus. I just happened to just now write that in my notes. So we'll get on to the other things. All right? Hear now the word of the living God. Romans 11, 33 through 36. Oh, the depth of the riches and wisdom and knowledge of God. How unsearchable are his judgments and unfathomable his ways. For who has known the mind of the Lord, or who became his counselor, or who has first given to him that it might be repaid to him? For from him and through him and to him are all things. To him be the glory forever. Amen. This is the word of God for the people of God and all of creation. But look at what it says. the depth of the riches and wisdom and knowledge of God. He says right here, you cannot search his judgments. And his ways, they're totally unfathomable. I can't even say the word. It's mind-boggling. Who's known the mind of the Lord? And really, it says, who became his counselor? Can anybody counsel God? Can anybody counsel God? Because he knows everything. Why would we even give that a shot? Like, I'm going to tell God my thoughts on the matter. I'm going to inform him on what I think should happen. But from him and through him and to him are all things. To him be the glory forever. Amen. When we see that word amen, it means I agree. I agree with God on that. So when we look at the omniscience of God, we're literally being put into a place by God to say, you're a person, he is God. Now, omniscience, let's take a look at that big word, omniscience. Omniscience means that God knows all things. He knows all things. And in your notes, I've got written down omni, that's the Latin, omni equals all, plus science or scientia equals knowledge, which equals, you put those two together, omniscience. And what we're really is God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. God, he knows all things. We don't have a clue. God knows all things. God knows all things. Isaiah 40, 28. Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. That is mind-blowing. He is God. He is God. He knows all things. He knows all things. He knows all things. God knows all things. Creation. In creation, he knows it and all things about it because he created it. That's a pretty basic, obvious statement. I think the more and more that we look at the omniscience of God, the fact that God knows everything, you're going to start to see this as an obvious thing with God. It is obvious that he knows all things. The very person of who he is should state in our hearts and our minds that God knows all things. But he knows all things about creation. In Genesis 1:1, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. To create something, you got to know something about it. And he does. Now, scientists estimate that there are, check this out, I can't wrap my mind, my little pea brain mind around this figure here, but scientists say that there are estimated 200 billion trillion stars in the universe. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm not a scientist. I play one on TV. No, just kidding. Folks, 200 trillion billion or billion trillion stars in the universe. Let me tell you something. Scientists, they don't have a clue. There's no way they can accurately give us that number. Whatever the number is, God knows it. And he knows all the stars. He knows the scientists. Listen to this in Psalm 147:4. God, he determines the number of the stars. He gives to all of them their names. Like, there's this website right now. You can buy a star for your loved one. Like, you can type it in, put in your credit card, and I'd like to pick that star and give it a name. You could do that, or you could save some cash and say God already named it. Your choice. But that's what Psalm 147:4 says. Also, Job 28:24, for he looks to the ends of the earth and sees everything under the heavens. Everything. Job 37:14-16, give ear to this, O Job. Stand and carefully consider the wondrous deeds of God. Do you know how God establishes them? and makes the lightning of his cloud to shine? Do you know about the layers of the thick clouds, the wonders of one perfect in knowledge? Do you know, Job? Do you know the wonders of one perfect in knowledge? Do you know the wonders of God? Do you, Job? He doesn't. We don't either. But God does. Because he knows. He knows, he knows, he knows. So God knows all things. He knows all things about creation. And God is omniscient. He knows all things in prophecy. I want you to put your seatbelts on because what we're getting ready to get into kind of gets into the nitty-gritty, and then a little bit later we're going to be talking about questions that we might have. If God is omniscient, then why do we pray? Why do we do this? Why do we do that? Fair questions. We'll get to that later. But right now, God is omniscient in prophecy because God knows all things. His prophecies are fulfilled. They're fulfilled every single time. Every single time. There's no guessing, oh, I got that prophecy wrong. No, this is biblical prophecy. When God gives a prophecy, it's always correct. And there's a recent false philosophy called open theism. Open theism. And it says that God knows everything that can be known up to this point, but he can't know the future. That's open theism. Now, this assumes that God is not sovereign, that he's not in control, that in fact, he's out of control. Because if you put that wrench into the machine stops working. It assumes that God is not perfect. And so if he's not perfect, then it leaves a vacuum of power. And what do people really want over God? They want power over God. It's true. Be your own queen, be your own king. So who's going to fill it? Who's going to fill that vacuum of power? If you really have open theism, if you really have a God that you've created in your own mind, well, he knows everything up to this point, but in the future, he doesn't know what's going to happen. If you really have that, you've got a vacuum of power, and the only person that's going to fill it is you, because you're your own God. So I have a couple of questions for the open theist. Question one, approximately when did God start not knowing the future? Look at your watch. Tell me when. Break out the calendar. When? That's unanswerable because prophecy has consistently come to pass at the exact time it was supposed to come to pass. And we're going to see that in just a minute. Question two, how did God rightly predict prophetic events in the past to actually come to pass if he can't know the future? How did he do that? So here's example one. God is the shepherd who tends his sheep. Jesus is the good shepherd. So Old Testament prophecy, Isaiah 40, verses 10 through 11. Behold, the Lord God comes with might, and his arm rules for him. Behold, his reward is with him, and his recompense before him. Verse 11, check this out now. He will tend his flock like a shepherd. He will gather the lambs in his arms. He will carry them in his bosom and gently lead those that are with young. Now here comes the New Testament prophetic fulfillment. John 10, 11. Jesus says about himself, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. Fulfillment of prophecy right there. Example two, that God is omniscient in prophecy. Here it comes. Jesus Christ's sacrifice offers forgiveness of sins, and specifically for our sins. Old Testament prophecy, Isaiah 53, 11, out of the anguish of his soul, he shall see and be satisfied by his knowledge. Shall the righteous one, my servant, here it comes, make many to be accounted righteous, and he shall bear their iniquities. That's Old Testament. Here comes New Testament. That was 700 years prior, by the way. Here comes New Testament. Acts 13, 38 through 39. Let it be known to you, therefore, brethren, that through this man, Jesus, forgiveness of sins is proclaimed to you, and here it comes, by him everyone who believes is freed from everything from which you could not be freed by the law of Moses. It is literally talking about Jesus freeing people from themselves and from the law of God that we cannot keep. Like the law of God says, don't commit adultery. Jesus comes along and says, if you even look at a person with lust in your heart, you've already committed the very act. What Jesus did on the cross is he literally freed us from sin. Prophecy fulfilled. So open theism is another attempt at sinful mankind to usurp the throne of God so that we can sit in that throne and we can become king. But God knows better. Isaiah 46:10, declaring the end from the beginning and from ancient times, things not yet done, saying, and listen to this, listen to what God says, my counsel shall stand and I will accomplish all my purpose. That is awesome. Awesome. So this verse not only shows that God knows all things, but he states that every second that goes by proves that his will come to pass. So God is omniscient in prophecy. Totally. 100%. Not only that, because God knows all things, God doesn't need to learn anything. Because God knows all things, God doesn't need to learn anything. We're in a constant state of change, constant state of learning. Did you know this? I think most of y'all know this, that every 7 years that goes by, your body has already kind of like recycled itself. You've got like new cells that have come in. I'm probably, gosh, how many cycles have I gone through? I don't know, but I was born in 1944. So you can imagine I've had a lot of cycles that I've gone through. I'm constantly learning. But God doesn't learn anything. As a matter of fact, Psalm 147:5 says, great is our Lord. I mean, we could just stop right there. Great is he. Great is our King. Great is our Savior. He is awesome. He is mighty. He is all powerful. He knows every single thing. He's awesome. Great is our Lord and abundant in power. His understanding, here it comes, his understanding is beyond measure. It's beyond. You can't measure it. And so God has no need to learn because he already knows. My former pastor from First Baptist Church in downtown Jacksonville, way back in the day, Dr. Jerry, he says this, has it ever occurred to you that nothing has ever occurred to God? Pardon me. He's right. He's right. Acts 15:18 says this, known to God from eternity are all his works. He didn't just say time. He said eternity. Like what we're dealing with here is we're dealing with a perfect being that has never been created. We're dealing with a perfect being that has never had a beginning, is right now, and will never end. How could that being possibly not know what's going on? How could he possibly not know all things? To a certain degree, that thought alone that God has never had a beginning is terrifying. How in the world could I ever sin against a being like this? That's hubris. How could I do that? What mercy he has. But God knows all things. He doesn't need to learn anything. And this is really neat too. We are part of God's acts in omniscience. We are part of God's acts in omniscience. Now, I want you to put on your ears and really listen to this because these are questions that you might have. These are kind of like fireside chat questions that we have every month. But we are part of God's acts and omniscience. So here's a question. Since God is all-knowing, he knows all things. Since God is all-knowing, then why pray? Why evangelize? Why go to school? Why go to work? The things that God is going to make happen, they're going to happen anyway. So what do I need to worry about? That is a fair question. And ladies and gentlemen, be very careful. When you're asking questions to God, please do so. Do so honestly, but do so reverently. What you don't want to do is ask God questions with an attitude. You don't. Go up to him reverently, boldly, but reverently, and ask questions. God loves to answer questions. He doesn't hide himself. He's there to answer questions. So here we go. Why pray? Why evangelize? If he's going to work all things out, then we might as well fall into what's called fatalism. Fatalism, which is the view that our choices don't affect the future. But ladies and gentlemen, that's not how God works. It's not how he works. We're not robots, but we're also not non-participants. We actually do participate. And throughout the Bible and throughout life, you're going to find that we cooperate with God in our faith and obedience with his omniscience. He uses our prayer and choices to accomplish his will. Kind of works like this. Like if you're a Christian, God calls you to be sanctified, meaning he calls you to be more and more holy. He calls you to be more and more like Jesus Christ. All right? Now, as you look, especially in the New Testament, what you have there in this sanctifying work is God is telling you to be sanctified. He is empowering you to be sanctified. He's giving you the power and the tools to do so. But you make the choice to go ahead and obey him. And one question I've asked our Thursday morning class is, who's sanctifying you? Is it God or is it you? And one of the things we like to say is, yes. God is empowering you. He already knows what's going to happen, but he's empowering you. But you, as a Christian, are taking the steps to say, I'm going to trust the Holy Ghost, and he's going to work and move through me. It's cooperation. We find the same thing here with God's omniscience. Let me explain it like this. When you and I are part of God decreeing and working out all things, life is about God's will being done, but he's using your choices and our choices to make that happen. Let me go into scripture. Matthew 6, 7 through 13. This is talking about praying and the model prayer. Some of you may know it as the Lord's Prayer. All right, listen up here. Here's what Jesus said. He says, and when you are praying, do not use meaningless repetition as the Gentiles do, for they suppose that they will be heard for their many words. Therefore, don't be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him. He knows what you need. Pray then in this way, our Father who is in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. So a few things on this. Jesus is saying, for yours is the kingdom and power and the glory forever. Amen. He is agreeing that his kingdom will come to pass because he knows all things. And he said that he knows all things earlier. Your Father knows your needs before you even ask him. And he knows that his kingdom is going to come to pass. So in between that holy sandwich, as it were, that omniscient sandwich, here it comes. On the one hand, we pray for his will to be done, but we also pray. On the one hand, we pray for his will to be done, but we also choose not to act like the hypocrites. On the one hand, we pray for his will to be done, but we also praise him. These are all acts that we are choosing to do. On the one hand, we are praying for his will to be done, but we also forgive people. This is all in this prayer here. We're choosing to do that. But on the other hand, there's my left, here's my right, here's the other hand. We pray for his will to be done, and God has decreed that his kingdom and his will come to pass. We pray for his will to be done, and it is his power that is making that happen. How do you understand that? By faith. And there have been people over and over throughout the centuries, great theologians, godly men and women, who have really tried to unscrew the unscrutable, and it can't happen. Ladies and gentlemen, you and I are, we can read what the Bible says, and we can take it by faith, and we should. We need to do that. But don't let this, the omniscience of God, or any other doctrine that's being taught, don't let it, number one, don't let it get in between muddying the water in your relationship with God, okay? Because there are many takes on this. But two, don't get into arguments with people. We're to love one another. We're to be truthful with one another. We're to give grace to one another. And to come out of one church service and say, I totally get it, no, we don't. We just don't. I have wrestled over this for years and years. My wrestling will stop when I kick the bucket. But I'll still be figuring out, God, how is it that you are omniscient? I can understand a little bit, but not everything. Listen to this. God, in his knowing all things, chooses to work with us and uses what we offer, which is our faith and effort, our obedience, to accomplish what he knows will happen. I'm going to say it a totally different way, but saying the same thing. God's attribute of omniscience and our effort and faith do not take away God's sovereignty, and it does not take away our power to choose. Rather, God uses both his power to choose and our choices to weave his will so that both his omniscience and our choice is used in the process to carry out his will. It's a lot of what I've just said. There's a lot of words there. Let me say it again. God's attribute of omniscience and our effort and faith do not take away God's sovereignty, and it doesn't take away our power to choose. Rather, God uses both his power to choose and our choices to weave his will together so that both his omniscience and our choices are used in the process to carry out his will. It is kind of mind-boggling, but basically what we're saying is that God is omniscient. He knows. The Bible does say that. But the Bible also says that we are choosing to do different things like pray and evangelize and all that. It's an amazing mystery. It's an amazing mystery. Now, let me tell you this. We're not going to get into this, but beyond this, different people of different denominations really get into the deep end of this kind of stuff. And we're not going to do that today. I don't know if we'll ever do that. But what I can tell you with a surety is that God is sovereign. He knows everything. And that he commands people to obey him. And some of them do. And somehow he works all that together. Are y'all kind of thinking of what? It's not in my notes, but I think it's definitely time to read this. Romans 8:28. Hello, here it comes. And we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good for those who are called according to his purpose. You love God. Jesus said, if you love me. You'll obey my commandments. And then it says, all things work together. Who's working that? The Lord. I will not be writing a book on this subject. But I am called to preach what the Word says. And this is what the Word says. I can give you both. It's tough. All right, let's look at this. Revelation 13:8, the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. That's our context. God knew that Christ would die on the cross. God also knew the exact seed that would be planted, human effort, that would produce the tree that someone would cut down, it's human effort again, and then would be brought to a carpenter to fashion the beams, human effort, that would eventually make a cross. On the other side of that coin, God also specifically created the atoms that would be the building blocks of the molecules that would make certain minerals that would come together to form the metal that would be mined out of the ground and then melted and cooled and then cut into the nails that would pierce into Jesus' wrists and feet. You have both. Here's something else that's mind-blowing. God also knew that Judas Iscariot would betray Jesus. And yet Judas was allowed to utilize his will to betray the Son of God. And all this, that the scripture would be fulfilled when it says in Revelation 13:8, the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. He was saying that in eternity past. And it came to pass during the timeline that Jeff preached about a couple of weeks ago. And by the way, if you haven't heard that message, you need to go and listen to his message about time. Let me encourage you to. That was a little bit harsh. I'm strongly encouraging you. Please listen to it. It's good stuff. So again, since God knows everything, why pray? Why evangelize? Why do anything? Our relationship with God is not built on what our expectations and the limitations of our understanding are. Rather, our relationship with God is built on the fact that he loves us, has rescued us, and knowing that he loves us, then we love him. 1 John 4:19. Here it comes again, the two coming together in perfect harmony. We love because he first loved us. And he knew that. ladies and gentlemen, if there is any reason to be saved, we're dealing with God here. Does he not deserve that we bow before him? We read things like this. He is God. He is God. So, God knows everything. Why pray, et cetera, et cetera. He commands it. We can't forget in the midst of our questioning and searching and all the rest, ladies and gentlemen, he is Lord. He commands it. And we obey. Don't forget, he's God. And just because our finite minds struggle with these amazing concepts, it doesn't mean that we can't put our faith into him. He's omniscient. He's perfect in every way. And we don't understand him, but we can trust him I mean, think about it. When you were little, your parents tell you to do something, and you don't do it, and it's something that they're trying to teach you, and what do they say? Good parents say, trust me. Just trust me. It's going to work out. Trust me. We don't understand it, but then we take that step of faith. Some of you are struggling with the fact that you haven't come to Christ yet, and you know it, and this may be part of your struggle point. Maybe not omniscience, but the fact that God is God, and you're really having trouble letting go. God understands that. He knows that. We'll get to that in a minute. But since God knows everything, why pray, et cetera, et cetera? God expects and assumes that we'll love and serve him. And there we go back to Matthew 6. Jesus says this, and when you are praying, he assumes that you're going to pray. Later on, he talks about fasting, and when you fast. Hello, we should be fasting on the regular according to what Jesus says. Not legalism, but out of grace. Since God knows everything, why do this, that, and the other? Because the love and forgiveness we've received, we want to trust him. Since God knows everything, why pray, et cetera, because we are able to cooperate and partner with him in accomplishing his will. Do you understand that when God tells us to do something, and by the way, God does not ask. There is nowhere in the Bible where God is commanding something that he asks us to do. Will you please do this? He doesn't do this. He commands, but he commands out of love and grace. But do you understand that when God commands us to do something, what's really going on is this amazing God of the universe and everything else is choosing to condescend and come to humans who are sinful by nature and partner with them. What love! What amazing grace! The Lord of the universe is choosing to partner with us. Oh, it is just weighty. I feel like right now, just shut my mouth. He is God. Something else about this, he is the paraclete. That's Greek for he's right alongside us. And he's right alongside us in ways that we can't comprehend. But when that's happening, we're cooperating with him in his omniscience, the things that he knows. We're a part of God's acts in omniscience. And I'm going to cover this part real quick. This is bonus content that I threw in at the last moment. And then we'll go on to the last point. But here's something. This is, if our minds aren't blown already, here comes another one. God knows what if outcomes. He knows what if outcomes. Matthew 11, 20 through 24. Then he began to denounce the cities in which most of his miracles were done. We're talking about Jesus. Because they did not repent. Verse 21. Woe to you, Chorazin. Woe to you, Bethsaida. For if the miracles had occurred in Tyre and Sidon, which occurred in you, they would have repented long ago in sackcloth and ashes. Verse 22, nevertheless, I say to you, it will be more tolerable for Tyre and Sidon in the day of judgment than for you. Verse 23, and Capernaum, you will be will you be exalted to heaven? You will descend to Hades. For if the miracles that had occurred in Sodom, which occurred in you, it would have remained to this day. Nevertheless, I say to you that it will be more tolerable for the land of Sodom in the day of judgment than for you. Let me tell you what Jesus is talking about. Jesus is saying that if he would have gone to Tyre and Sidon with his message of believe and repent instead of Chorazin and Bethsaida, they would have repented. Here's what's happening here. Jesus knew the outcome of an alternate event that could have happened but didn't. This didn't even happen. And he's letting us know it was an alternate event that could have happened. And he knows that. I don't know where to go with that. This is the mind of God. And it could be said that he's making a judgment on their character. But ladies and gentlemen, this is the Lord of time and eternity. Here's a practical point. When we have a God like this, and I'm making this point again, that has no beginning and no ending, who knows everything whatsoever will come to pass, it behooves us to receive his love and forgiveness and to live for him. It behooves us to do that. Last thing, God knows you. Now, for some of us, that's a scary thought. But for some of us, that's an amazing, awesome, wonderful oasis thought. Psalm 139, 1 through 6. Oh, Yahweh, you have searched me and know me. You know when I sit down and when I rise up. You understand my thought from afar. You scrutinize my path and my lying down and are intimately acquainted with all my ways. Even before there is a word on my tongue, behold, Yahweh, O Yahweh, you know it all. You have enclosed me behind and before. You have put your hand on me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is too high. I cannot attain to it. So he knows you. God knows you. Job 34, 21, for his eyes are on the ways of a person and he sees all their steps. Whew. Like there is nothing hidden from him. Now, quickly, he knows the ones who will not bow the knee to Christ. Matthew 7, 21 through 23, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father who is in heaven will enter. And those who will do the will of the Father are those who have believed and placed their faith. So this is not a thing of works. Many will say to me, Lord, Lord, in your name did we not prophesy, and in your name cast out demons, and in your name do many miracles? Then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness. That word knew or know in the Greek, it's a word called gnosko. Gnosko, I never knew you. In this context, now gnosko is a Greek word that has many different meanings. It has a general meaning to know, but it has many different meanings within that. So you have a meaning and then sub-meanings. That's how the Greek works. Gnosko. Jesus said, I never knew you. He's talking to those who have refused to put their faith in Christ. And he says, depart from me, you who practice lawlessness. And he says, I never knew you. And that word specifically right there means I never had any acquaintance with you. It's like, I knew you as a friend. We used to hang out, whatnot. No, we're not even acquaintances. So God doesn't know that person in a way of salvation. But he does know all things about them. And judgment will come. Romans 2:16, on the day when, according to my gospel, God will judge the secrets of men through Christ Jesus. And the only way that God can judge is if he knows. And he knows all about the person who is lost. And he doesn't want it that way. He doesn't desire that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. But here's some very sweet stuff. This is super cool. This is really neat. So God knows. We've talked about theologically how God knows. We've talked about practically how God knows. But now let's, and we've covered some difficult questions and whatnot, but now let's go into, like, God knows you, those of you that have come to Christ. Whether you're Ancient of Days, seasoned citizens, or you're young teenagers or anybody in between, just let this minister to your heart. John 10:27, my sheep hear my voice and I know them, gnosko, and they follow me. This gnosko is a deep, abiding love. Not only that, but a knowing love. This is a wow love. Like, you are God and you love me. And you know me and you want to be there with me. You want to be my paraclete. Matthew 10:26-31. He's talking, Jesus is talking to the disciples about this is how you be a disciple. So have no fear of them, for nothing is covered that will not be revealed or hidden that will not be known. Why? Because he knows all things. What I tell you in the dark, say in the light. And what you hear whispered, proclaim on the housetops. Get together with God and read his word. So he will share things with you that you need to tell. And don't fear those who kill the body, but cannot kill the soul. Rather, fear him who can destroy both soul and body in hell. Are not two sparrows sold for a penny, and not one of them will fall to the ground apart from your Father, but even the hairs of your head are all numbered. Fear not, therefore. You are of more value than many sparrows. So he knows and he values his own because he has a close communal relationship with them. And when you know that you're known by God, righteousness will happen for God's children. Have no fear of them, for nothing is covered that will not be revealed. God speaks to his children. God is word. When you know God and you're known by him, God's children have a long, reverence, loving relationship towards God because they know that they are loved by him. His word says so. If everybody turns you away and you're a Christian, know that you have Christ. Don't fear those who kill the body but cannot kill the soul. Rather, fear him who can destroy both soul and body in hell. You need to understand what a powerful thing it is to be loved by God. And a God that commands reverence. Those of you who had good parents growing up, you knew what it was like that when you messed up, they would discipline you and they were right to do it. And you end up coming back later on after your teenage years saying, thanks, Mom, thanks, Dad, I appreciate it. I know not all of us had a good upbringing, but for those of us that did, you come back saying, I thank you. This is God the Father. A reverence. And when you know God and you're known by him, you understand that you're so cared for and loved because he even cares about the smallest thing about you. Are not two sparrows sold for a penny? Not one of them will fall on the ground apart from your Father, but even the hairs of your head are numbered. Psalm 56:8. You have taken account of my wanderings. You put my tears in your bottle. Are they not in your book? You have such, oh, goodness, goodness gracious, if you were a Christian, you have such value with God and love and care. And we sin, we do, but there's such tremendous, deep, abiding love and care towards you. He knows that you would sin after you came to Christ. Even when we were yet sinners, Christ died for us, the Bible says. So fear not, you're more valuable than many sparrows. I had something else written down here. It was Matthew 6, 25 through 34, but talking about all the different things that people are worried about. He knows you need these things. But what do we want to do as Christians? We want to seek first his kingdom, his righteousness, and then we know because he loves us, because he knows us, all these things will be added to us. So don't worry about tomorrow. Tomorrow's going to worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. Ladies and gentlemen, if you're a Christian, you need to know that God loves you. And even when you sin, 1 John 3:20, for if our heart condemns us, God is greater than our heart and knows all things. He knows. R.C. Sproul, who has gone on to be with the Lord, he had a very much of a grandfatherly way of giving deep concepts to the masses. And I want you to listen to what he says. To know that God knows everything about me and yet loves me is indeed my ultimate consolation. When you know the depth of your sin and yet Christ loves you in the midst of that, be comforted. Be comforted. Lord, we are in awe of who you are, and not just because of your omniscience and not just because of your great love, but because of you. Your God. We thank you. In the name of Christ, amen. Let's prepare our hearts for communion.